YouTube. Robert the Coroner Drap here, just fresh off the NXT Championship of NXT TakeOver Orlando. This was a crazy night. We had great matches from a lot of folks, and I'm gonna try and do two cameras this time. It's gonna be fun. But we're gonna start with Sanity versus No Way versus Roderick Strong, No Way Jose, Ruby Riott, and Ty Dillinger. They showed a clip from NXT Access where Sanity attacked No Way Jose and took him out. That meant they had to find somebody else, and that somebody else ended up being Cassius Ohno. Now, I'm not very familiar with Mr. Ohno's work so far, but from what I've seen at the moment, he seems to be a pretty good wrestler. You know, can't say nothing bad about him. There was a lot, I mean, really a lot of hard shots by Cassius Ohno. That was his thing. He was a striker, a fighter. So it'll be interesting to see in the future how this whole thing goes. You know, how the experiment with seeing Cassius Ohno in a singles role goes. It'll be very interesting. Ty Dillinger, as usual, super over. I mean, there's no reason not for him to be. This was a good match. Ruby Riott, I wrote here, Ruby Riott isn't bad. She has legit cred, it seems. Like, she knows what she's doing. She knows how to swing, how to actually wrestle. And she wrestles in that similar, I'm crazy, so I'm gonna go nuts on your ass kind of style. Something to look out for. There was the Roderick's sick kick that nearly kill sick kick kills Eric Young. And I also wrote that I see a lot of money in the future for Ruby Riott, Nikki Cross matches. Those are going to be damn good when they get around to putting them together. Sanity wins. They didn't need to. This is the problem that I have with Sanity. And I guess this will get into my maybe lack of watching. Sanity doesn't really have a lot of competition. There's not a lot up for them to do. But they're good to watch. I enjoy watching what they do. But what are they going to do? Are they going to take over the tag team division? There's only two or three teams in the tag team division. We're not counting Sanity, even though they are a tag team. And they absolutely should be trying to terrorize the Authors of Pain. That should be a thing. But unfortunately, for WWE, that is, they've decided, no, we don't need to do that. No, that doesn't need to be a thing. Let's see, what else we got here? Andrade Cien Almas versus Aleister Black. Now, this guy is apparently Tommy End. Never watched him before. But if you watch my preview and predictions, you'll note that I have a problem with what they do with Andrade Cien Almas, in that he's always seemed to be built up as a, you know, a good heel that can really, he'll annoy the piss out of you, but he's hardcore about beating the crap out of you. And then, oops, can't
can't win the big ones, you know. Aleister Black's entrance was way over. Like, he did a whole Michael Myers Undertaker kind of rising up with smoke and darkness and a single light on him. And then he walks down the ring. He's got, like, all these candles behind him on the Titantron, and it's just an insane kind of entrance. And even his name was written in some sort of crazy script that I've never seen before. But it was super cool. And he got in the ring. He's got all these tattoos. He takes off his vest. He sits in the middle in lotus position, you know, legs crossed, hands in front of him, just taking it in and trying. It looks like he's almost meditating with his eyes open, you know. Oh, God. Let's see. There was a point where he was going to, it looked like he was going to springboard, like he was going to suicide out to the outside, and Andrade, like, moved out of the way, like, ran the other way around. And as he was running, he springboards off the middle rope, lands on his feet, drops instantly back down to the lotus position. It's like, are you even human? That's insane. That's crazy. What have you. Andrade did that yelling slap thing he does. Like, he ran right up to him. Ah! Smack! That does nothing, dude. Stop it. Stop it. Let's see. There was a double super kick. Oh, the second rope, the second outside turnbuckle moonsault by Aleister Black was just bananas. He landed on his feet. That's what's made it crazy. It was the fact that he landed on his feet. But, you know. Let's see what else we got here. Yeah, I gotta say, Aleister Black's got some real chops when it comes to, some real cred when it comes to kicking. He's got some beautiful kicks. He kicked him until he was down. Like, he did those WWE kicks. And then he used his foot underneath his chin to lift him back up to his feet and did a spinning heel kick that went and caught him flush right on the side of the net. Right there. Beautiful. Beautiful. Y'all know I love my WWE. I loved this whole pay-per-view, to be honest. I had such fun watching it. It was great. There were things that I expected to see that I didn't see. There was even a flub by the ring announcer. He was announcing the tag team championships and announced it as the NXT championship. These things, you know, it's life. It's funny. That's cool. DIY versus Revival versus the Authors of Pain. I had no idea how this tag team match was going to work. I thought it was going to be three men in the ring, each one trying to get the first pinfall or submission. Failing that, and just like in a regular triple threat match, if you are in a tag team triple threat match, doesn't matter who you are, there are no disqualifications, and if somebody else submits while the champs are incapacitated for any reason, this then leads to the champs losing the title and the title changing hands. No. Apparently, the way this works is two men are in the ring at a time. Doesn't matter which two, but if you get tagged by anybody that's not on your team, or hell, even if you get tagged by somebody on your team, they're in the ring with the other legal person. So somebody could tag your opponent, tag themselves in, they're legal, the other team is not. I predicted that, you know, the Authors of Pain would win this one because the Revival are apparently, you know, metagaming this bit. The Revival are going to go to SmackDown, I feel. That tag team division needs some work, needs some competition, or needs to actually start having competition, but we're going to go on. There was a DIY Revival team up to start. Like they each picked each team of guys. Two of their guys picked one of the Authors of Pain and they went after him. I was not against this because I felt like that's the only way you're going to beat the Authors of Pain is by, okay, we all have to get together on this and take him out. It's just like a Brock Lesnar match. You have to take Brock out of the match. If you don't take Brock out of the triple threat match, Brock is going to win. Because he's a monster. They started out teasing a table spot. And then Occam drove both of the guys from DIY, Tommaso Ciampa and Johnny Gargano, into the guardrail. I thought that was a really cool thing. And there was Gargano wanted to tag out, and one of the guys from the Revival had his hand out like he was gonna tag himself in. And then they stepped down the ramp just a bit. You're stuck in there with him. We don't like you. We want you to lose. Why would we help you? I don't know. Maybe because you're facing two absolute monsters in the ring that are built up to be that they can go into a handicap match against the better part of your division here on NXT. And win. Handily, they can win. But no, let's not team up. That's stupid. Doesn't make any sense. It happened again later with Revival and DIY. It was dumb. It took four guys, all four of the other members in this match, to put one of the Authors of Pain through the table. I thought this was going to be their way of, you know, easily getting the tag team titles onto Revival, or more likely DIY, because hey, you know, it's a triple threat rule. Triple threat rules. We put him through a table. It's not illegal because there are no rules in this. There was a second rope spear that I quite liked by, Ciampa. No, Gargano. The way he did that short, like, springboard, like, launched himself from the second rope was good. Like that. There was this superplex that was just insane. Like, one of the Revival had Ciampa, I believe it was, on the top rope, like he was going to do a superplex, and I thought this was going to get countered, right? No, they did a superplex from the top rope onto the outside, onto everybody else. It was so shocking I didn't spell outside right. UOT. This is insane. They started chanting fight forever. There was a lot of holy shit. And that was probably the highlights of the match. This is where it fell apart. One of the members of the Revival grabs Ciampa, rolls him into the ring. Okay, you know, while the announcers are, why don't you just roll the champs into the ring and pin one of them? It'll be easy. Everybody's down. You've been beating on them for all this time. Dude, pin the guy you just superplexed. Get rid of him. And then, this is, I think, the part that everybody wanted to shit on this match for. And rightly so. Authors of Pain fucking no-sold all of that, because I think it was Razor reaches in, smacks Revival A. I'm going to call them, because I don't know their names. I don't really care. I'll learn them later, I'm sure. Smacks Revival A on the back, tag himself in, right? Like, clobbers him, instantly takes down he clobbers him, like, pushes him out the ring, picks up Ciampa in that, you know, that headlock, backs up, gets tagged. They hit the final chapter on him, that where one of them runs past, comes forward and does like a clothesline while the other one falls backwards. Hit that on him, 1, 2, 3, DIY is eliminated. That's where they started just absolutely shitting on this match. Just boo. Just you couldn't get less over unless you had Roman Reigns out there. That's how loud it was. That's how bad it was. But it gets worse. So much worse. Then, because they no-sold the injuries they'd taken previously, they start beating the crap out of the Revival. Just absolutely destroying them. There was chance of Delete, CM Punk, bullshit, you name it. They every derogatory, auditory sound that could probably be made was made at this match. And I can't honestly say I blame the crowd. They booked this completely wrong. If you were going to have them bulldoze, if you were going to have them bulldoze both teams, have them do it straight, you know? Like, nobody else can tag in. Everybody's getting tagged by each other. And even then, they couldn't take down the Authors of Pain. Or, alternatively, have the Authors of Pain lose. They don't have a streak like Asuka. They're unbeaten, sure, but it's not as impressive at the moment. Nobody cares. It's not that important. But no, you wanted to put the new tag team belts on the old tag team champions. Good job. Authors of Pain retain. I did call it. I really did. I knew it was going to happen, but I thought it was going to be better than that. I thought the ending was going to be better than that. It pretty much... There was more than one set of people's, you know, boo, you know, thumbs down. A couple people giving the finger. It was insane. But... Now on to a match I was legit excited for. Ember Moon versus Asuka. They unveil a new NXT champion, women's champion belt. It's basically the same NX, the big X, with T. But this time, because I couldn't really see the new tag team belts, I couldn't really tell. So, but the X is, you know, prominent, and on the women's belt, I believe it's silver background, gold background, silver diamond X. Cool, like it. Let's do this. It was very even at the start, and they were really hammering at each other. I'm talking stiff shots the whole way. They had each other very well scouted. There was a couple times where they went for the same move. It was like, oh, no, I see. I got you. No, you're doing me. I see where you're going with this. They even let Ember get a guardrail spot in. Like, Asuka knocked her off the thing and she hit her head on the guardrail. Wow, that's amazing. I like that. Let him go, please. This was a great match. I feel bad that it had to follow that tag team match. In fact, I think if this one would have went on before the NXT Championship match, they would have shit hard all over that match. It would have been way worse. Let's see. There was a really brutal forearm by Ember Moon that sent Asuka to the outside, and then it followed up by a crossbody. Like, she hit the forearm, Asuka's rolled outside. She runs over into the corner, bounces off the second rope, and crossbodies her. Wow. You know, they threw everything at each other. This was a damn good match. The one part that I really... Oh, yeah. Ember Moon, like, did a backdrop while in the Asuka lock. Like, there was a couple points where she looked like she was about to pass out, or she had passed out on her feet. And, you know, she, like... Oh, I'm up. Oh, I'm down. Oh, I gotta fight. Let me get to the ropes. I can't get to the ropes. Ah, screw it. I'm standing up, and then flop. Straight back. That's how I would have done it. That's how I'd have done it the first time. Fuck, even better. How about rolling backwards into a fucking pin? You'll be sitting on her goddamn face. Double bonus for us. It'll be hard for her to kick out, and we'll all get a show. Why not? There was this fucking stupid ref bump. And I legit almost yelled, what the fuck? Why wasn't she disqualified? Ember Moon's going for the eclipse. She's on the second rope. She's hit a bulldog. Like, she pushed Asuka off because they've been, you know, exchanging shots. So everybody's, you know, woozy. She's about to jump for it. And as she's put her foot on the top rope, Ember, who's been kind of staggering this whole time, shoves the ref into the opposite ropes. So she's on this side, shoves him into the ones that are this way. And Asuka, she's like, racks herself, you know, gets out, I think she did like a German suplex or something. She hit a suplex, and then 1, 2, 3, there's your end. On the one hand, Asuka, you know what, leaning hard into Asuka being a heel rather than just being a monster who's kind of like, I'm not a good guy, I'm not a bad guy, I just beat the shit out of people, and it doesn't matter, I don't care, I'm not going to be face or heel. No, lean into a character, pick a side, that's fine. You don't necessarily have to, but I'm glad you've done it. Choose one, it won't kill you. Shinsuke Nakamura versus Bobby Roode. The entrances, as always, are amazing. Shinsuke got kind of a normal, for him, entrance. Like, there was no violin players, there were no fancy things. Bobby Roode, on the other hand, he got two chicks playing a piano. Like, playing this piano piece before he started. And then he got his theme song. I don't think anybody sung it, but I think that it was there, so let's do this, right? There's another new title belt for the men. This time with a gold X. Works, you know? Not bad. There's dueling chants of Shinsuke and of Bobby Roode and Nakamura to start off the match. This match was one of those ones where there weren't a lot of flashy spots. There really weren't. But the match was solid all the way through, bell to bell. There was a really good armbar sequence where Shinsuke, having hurt his knee, did the armbar, like full out doing an armbar. And even after getting like he got slammed onto his back and had to let go, he found a way to get back into it again. So that's, you know, that's great. Do it. Bobby Roode hit a backstabber for a close two. But I think the part that got me was that after the whole thing, Bobby Roode had to climb onto the top rope, do like a tornado, landing on his feet with Shinsuke, like under his arm. So he had him in front of him on the top rope. So he jumps off spinning and then picks him up and hits the glorious DDT. And it was the second glorious DDT he had to do. Because he really hurt his arm in that match. Like, I think he hit a guardrail. I think that's a work. Like, they planned that. Bobby Roode even went and got the ring bell. Like, he walked over, grabbed the ring bell, smacked it on the turnbuckle a couple times, got in the ring. The ref's like, "The fuck are you doing? No, give me that. You have to listen to me. Give me that ring bell." He's like, "I don't care. Disqualify me. Nope. Pulled it away from him, gave it back to the guy. I thought he was going to do something dastardly, no? Didn't happen. But, no. Rumor, again, has it that Shinsuke's going to be on SmackDown or Raw. So. For a go-away, a send-off match, it's not too bad. It's better than Revival got. Not by much. Overall, if I had to rate this pay-per-view, I would say this one was I want to say a 7 out of 5. Not badly put together, very well written. The winners made sense, even if the endings sucked. So, not bad. I probably won't watch it again. And tomorrow, I'm going to try and do this from the place where I'm going to watch. And we're talking about watching the pre-show, which apparently starts at 4. Till next time. This has been your NXT review and results from Robert the Coroner Drap. Please like, comment, subscribe. Do all those wonderful things that make my YouTube channel feel real good. Have a good one, guys.